San Antonio, Texas, just down the road. You ever been to San Antonio? Yeah? Well, I hope you'll come again. Come and see us at Oak Hills Church. Maybe not all at once. I've admired and appreciated the work of your wonderful congregation now for, well, decades, I guess. And I've been in San Antonio at the Oak Hills Church since 1988. They're so tired of me. They're so happy when I travel. They've been telling me that my sermons are getting too long. Too long. I'm getting old and the sermons are getting long. Not long ago, I was preaching and a guy got up right in the middle of one of my sermons and started walking out. Just walking out. I stopped everything. I said, "Hey, buddy, where are you going?" He said, "I'm going to get a haircut." I said, "Well, why didn't you get one before you came in?" He said, I didn't need one before I came in." We're not too sophisticated as you big city folk are. You know, down there in San Antonio, we're not too polished. I mentioned to the congregation some time ago that I would be leaving immediately after the service because I was going to go to Manhattan and speak. So I hurried out the building and was running to the car, and a lady caught me in the parking lot. She said, "Did you say you were going to Manhattan?" I said, "I did." She said, "Well, could you say hello to my son while you're there?" I said, "Well, it's a short trip, you know, busy city. Hey, here, give me his contact information and let's see what happens." She said, "That's the problem. We don't know where he is. We can't find him. He's somewhere in New York." And I'm thinking maybe you'll just bump into him. I said, "That's not going to happen. You just don't bump into somebody. I'm not going to Mule Shoe, Texas. You don't bump into somebody in Manhattan." She said, "You never know. Just keep an eye out for him. Maybe in a restaurant or on the street. Keep an eye out for a guy named John Dunn." I said, "I'm sorry, that's just not going to happen." She said, "Keep an eye out for him. John Dunn." Well, wouldn't you know, I was walking down a major thoroughfare, and I noticed that over the entryway to a building were the words Dunn and Bradstreet. And I thought, that guy's name was John Dunn. Could it be? So I went in. I went up to the receptionist. I said, "Ma'am, can you tell me, do you have a John here?" She said, "We do. Down the hall, first door to the right." I thought, "Wow, isn't this interesting?" So I went down the hall, first door to the right. I walked in, and there was a gentleman stepping out of the stall. I said, "Sir, are you done?" He said, "I am." I said, "Then call your mother." You know, you just never know, do you? You never know how it might work out. I'd like us to think for just a few moments today about the words that the angel spoke to Joseph. You'll remember these words from the first chapter of Matthew. The angel said, "Joseph, son of David, don't be afraid to take Mary home as your wife, because what is conceived in her is from the Holy Spirit. And she will give birth to a son, and you are to name him, give him the name Jesus, because he will save his people from their sins." Heavenly Father, would you please let your blessing be upon the message, and would you please let your grace and forgiveness be upon the messenger, for his sins are many. Grant that we can see Jesus, just Jesus. Through Christ we pray, and all the church said. I tried to blame my misbehavior on the holiday traffic. The Thanksgiving weekend had turned the streets near the shopping mall into controlled chaos. I tried to blame my misdeeds on my state of mind. My wife's mother was ever weakening near death. We had spent that day planning her funeral. I was, in fact, returning from a trip to the cemetery. I tried to blame my poor reaction on the reckless, illegal U-turn made by the teenager. He nearly clipped my bumper. The green light had given me permission to make a right turn onto a busy avenue. But as I did, this muscle car made an unexpected, and did I mention, illegal U-turn around the median and pulled right in front of me. We nearly shared paint. I pressed on my brakes, voided the contact, but then I honked at him. And I'll confess, it was not a polite honk. Not a tap, tap, I'm over here type honk. It was more of a honk. Did you see what you almost did? And I pulled in behind him and followed him down the street because I was just, he was headed the same way I was. He drove a low-riding, two-toned, exhaust-puffing jalopy that dated back to the 80s. It needed a better muffler. And it also needed a more mature passenger. Because as I was behind the car, after I honked, the passenger window came down. And a long arm came out of the window. And the arm gave me an unsolicited, backhanded, one-fingered wave. I sped up. And thanks to a traffic light, within a matter of moments, I was side by side with the perpetrator. My driver's side next to the passenger side. I looked down. His window was still down. He was just a kid. Wore a baseball hat, shoved over a mop of black hair. The brim of the hat faced sideways, and so did the smirk on his face. So I looked down at him, and I looked down on him. And I said, "You need to watch that wave, son." In an ideal world, he would have apologized. He would have called me sir. I would have wished him a Merry Christmas. And I wouldn't be telling you this story. But the world is not ideal. And when I told him to watch that wave, he smirked even more, and he looked up at me, and he said, "Make me." Make me. When was the last time someone said, "Make me" to me? Middle school? There was this scuffle after high school graduation. I think somebody might have said, I could not remember. When was the last time somebody said, "Make me" to me? That's what teenagers say. Of course, he was a teenager. He didn't have a whisker on him. He was a skinny, floppy-haired, testosterone-laden adolescent who was feeling his oats, riding shotgun in his buddy's muscle car. As for me, I'm a 60-plus-year-old pastor. I write Christian books. I'm supposed to make the world a better place. But I didn't. I should have raised my window. But I didn't. I looked down on him again. And I said, "Now what did you say?" And he looked up with even more of a smirk and said it again, "Make me." All this is all of me. All of a sudden, I was an expert on where to go to duke it out. The light changed. I accelerated. And I looked in my side view mirror, and I saw that they did not. They were stopped, and they were talking to each other, these two teenagers. Of course, I couldn't hear what they were saying, but I have a good idea. What do you think we ought to do? Well, I don't know. You started it. Well, I don't know. He looks pretty mad to me. What do you think? I don't know. You think we could take him? I don't know. He might be packing. What are we going to do? And all of a sudden, their left blinker turned on, and they turned into a parking lot and disappeared, and boy, was I relieved. I drove the rest of the way to my in-law's house thinking, what did I just do? What happened? Where did that come from? I'd like to blame my behavior on my state of mind or upon the holiday traffic or upon the teenager who made that, did I mention illegal U-turn? But really, I can only blame my bizarre behavior on one thing. And that is the punk inside of me. For a few minutes at a stoplight near a shopping mall, I forgot who I was. And I forgot who he was. He wasn't a creation of God. He wasn't fearfully and wonderfully made. He wasn't someone's son. He wasn't a potential miracle. He was a disrespectful jerk, and I let him bring the disrespectful jerk out of me. Now, the Bible has a name for this punkish tendency, and the name is sin. Sin. The sinful nature is this stubborn, self-centered, my way or the highway attitude that indwells all of us. As is often said, sin is best defined by its middle letter. I. Sin is a world that is built around I, what I want, what I think, what I need. Sin places I in the I and sees the world through just one lens, and that is the lens of self. It's a sinful nature. I was born with a sinful nature, and so were you. Merry Christmas. Under the right circumstances, you will do the wrong thing. Am I correct? Under the right circumstances, you will do what you would right now say, oh, I'll never do that. But you would, under the right circumstances, given the right mixture of conditions and temptations, you will do the wrong thing, something that would cause you to, after you do it, say, no, what was I thinking? Why did I do that? From where did that come? You'll try not to, but you will. And the reason is because you have a sin nature. We all do. We were born with it. Our parents didn't have to teach us how to throw a temper tantrum, right? Somehow we just knew. No one had to show you how to steal a cookie from your sibling. You never attended a seminar on how to pout or pass the blame. Someone did have to teach you to say thank you, but no one had to teach you to say mine or no. It was inborn. You were born speaking the language of sin. When our oldest daughter, Jenna, was born, we really thought we had been given the exception to the rule when it came to sin nature. You know how parents look at their newborn and say, oh, that's just a perfect baby. Well, we said that, and we were serious. I thought we had the perfect baby. She was perfect. She deserved to be carried on a pillow and right in a carriage. She set a new standard for cuddletivity. I sent her picture to the baby magazine, told them, put her on the cover. Never heard back, but she was perfect. But then as Jenna grew older, we began to question her royal lineage. Maybe the best way to say this is she began to behave more and more like her mother's side of the family. And she learned a word. I don't know who taught her this word, but somewhere she learned the word no. Did your children learn that word? No. Jenna, it's time to go to bed. No. Where did that come from? Jenna, it's time to take a bath. No. Where does that come from? And we realized that our perfect little girl had this independent, stubborn streak. And it didn't go away with her diapers. And neither did yours, nor did mine. It's still there. And though on the outside we may for a time appear to have it all together, within us there is this selfish, stubborn streak. And God says, forgive your enemies. And we say, no. God says, cherish your family. No. And God says, don't be anxious. We say, no. Where does it come from? Each one of us entered the world with a sin nature. That's true. But here's the good news. God entered the world to take it away. This book this year is called Because of Bethlehem. And it's a simple thesis. Because of Bethlehem, how is the world different? What happened in Bethlehem with the birth of Christ that changed everything? At the top of the list, I think, would be an answer somewhat like this. Because of Bethlehem, we know the day and the way God saved us from ourselves. Look carefully at the words that the angel spoke to Joseph. He said, Joseph, son of David, do not be afraid to take Mary home as your wife, because what is conceived in her is from the Holy Spirit. And she will give birth to a son, and you are to give him the name Jesus, because he will save his people from their sins. Now, you and I don't quickly see the connection between the name Jesus and the phrase save people from their sins, but Joseph, who knew the Hebrew language, would have immediately seen that. Jesus, in English, the Hebrew form of Jesus, traces its ancestry back to a word that means God saves. God saves. So when Joseph heard the name Jesus, he really heard the phrase, God saves. Now that's a great name. We've got a new student in our class. What's your name, young man? Oh, my name's God Saves. The son of Joseph is visiting us. He works at the carpentry shop. What's your name, young man? Oh, I'm God Saves. The perfect name for Jesus, God Saves. Because according to the Bible, he is God. He is, yes, godly, yes, God-seeking, yes, God-worshiping, but he is God in the flesh. And he came to save. Yes, he came to teach. Yes, he came to help. Yes, he came to instruct. Yes, he came to heal. But most of all, he came to save. And according to the angel, you should call him God Saves, because he has come to save his people from their independent, stubborn, punkish tendencies. He has come to save his people, not just from bad weather or bad news, or bad health or bad politicians or bad economies. He has come to save us from sin. And here's why. God has high plans for you and me. God has high plans for you and me. He is redeeming for himself a people with whom he will populate a redeemed universe and a redeemed planet. He is redeeming for himself a people, a population from every tribe, tongue, and language with whom he will populate a redeemed earth and a redeemed universe. And he invites you and he invites me to be a part of that eternal or heavenly population, the sons of God. He will have his Garden of Eden. His plan has not changed. The day is coming and may soon be in which we will indwell a garden of perfection as God intended. And we will walk with him in the cool of the evening. It will be a new day. It will be a new era. It will be a new millennium. It will be a new kingdom. Problem is, that kingdom will be perfect, and you and I are anything but. You want to say amen? Amen. You don't have to, but it's true. That kingdom will be perfect, and you and I are anything but. We can't even keep our self-control at a stoplight, for crying out loud. So what's God going to do? Start over with a new species of humans somewhere on another planet? I guess he could. But he loves us too much for that. Maybe he'll just populate the eternal kingdom with imperfect people. But heaven wouldn't be heavenly. If you carry your independence and I carry my independence into the new kingdom. Besides, the Bible promises that in the new kingdom, the curse will be gone. So what's God going to do? Well, his answer, his solution, revolves around the name God saves. Jesus. And the scripture teaches us that there was something special about Jesus. The Bible says that God was pleased for all of himself to live in Christ. All the love of God was in Jesus. All the wisdom of God was in Jesus. All the power of God was in Jesus. All the perfection of God was for a time wrapped in human flesh, indwelling a simple carpenter in a one camel town called Nazareth. All of God was pleased to dwell in Christ. No wonder the waves became silent when Jesus spoke. That was God speaking. And no wonder the people listened with rapt attention and said, he speaks with such authority. Well, that was God teaching. And no wonder the bacteria fled when Jesus healed, because that was God healing. And it's no wonder that the legions of angels stood in rapt attention when they nailed Jesus to the cross, because that was God dying. He let them crucify him for heaven's sake. The Apostle Paul said, Christ had no sin, but God made him become sin so that we could become right with God. There's the solution. He had no sin, but God took all of the sin, mine and yours, and placed it upon Christ and punished it there so that we can enter the new kingdom perfect, perfectly forgiven. The justice of God is satisfied, and the love of God is demonstrated. And the new kingdom is populated by people made perfect by the sacrifice of Christ. But there's more. He not only did a work for us, but he does a work in us. When you said yes to Christ, he said yes to you. When you gave him your heart, he returned the favor. And he placed his heart within you, the very presence of the Holy Spirit. He did with you what he did with Mary. He was a fetus in her. He is a force in you. And just as he grew within her until he had to come out, she had no choice but to deliver him into the world. So he grows in his children today until he has to come out. He comes out in our language. He comes out in our eyes. He comes out in our hands. He comes out in our checkbooks. He comes out in our kindness. He comes out in our hospitality. And we begin to find ourselves doing things that we used to not do, and loving people that we used to disdain, and forgiving people who really don't deserve to be forgiven, because it's God working within us. As one apostle said, he decided at the outset to shape the lives of those who love him along the same lines as the life of his son. God has an agenda with you because he's going to populate you, use you to populate the new kingdom. He populates you now with himself. And as you grow in Christ, Christ grows in you. As you grow in Christ, Christ grows in you. His goal is to change you every day a little bit more from glory to glory into the presence of Christ, into the image of Christ. It's almost as if God has a list of the characteristics of Christ here, and he has a list of the characteristics of Max here, and every time the two do not match, guess who gets to change? Not Christ. But God is working on Max, shaping Max, changing Joe, changing Ellen, changing Tom, changing his children more and more every day into the presence of Christ. This is the work of the Holy Spirit who lives within us. Now, we will never be sinless, but with God as our helper, we will sin less. Some of you need to hear that today. I just sense it in my heart. You think you're going to be battling this addiction for all of your life. With God as your helper, you won't. You think you're going to be battling this prejudice all of your life. With God as your helper, a breakthrough is coming. You think you're going to be battling this bad habit for the rest of your days. No, you're not. With God as your helper, he will stand down Satan. He will rise up his son, and the same power that rose Christ from the dead is the power that lives inside of you. And so do not give in to the fear. Do not give in to the doubt. Do not give in to the cynicism. Say, okay, Lord, let's just keep going. Let's keep going. Your mercies are new every morning. So here's morning. I need your mercies. I'm pressing in. And more you press into God, and in time, and sometimes all of a sudden, that struggle or that stronghold or that foothold of the devil is just gone. And may it happen to you. But even when you stumble, here's the great news. The grace that saved you initially sustains you eternally. The grace that saved you initially sustains you eternally. What matters is not so much your perfection, but the perfection of Christ. And since he died on the cross, you received his perfection. He took on your imperfection. You are once and forever holy, sanctified in the eyes of God. So you cannot lose your salvation. Boy, that's good news, isn't it? What matters is not so much your hold on God, but his hold on you. And his hold is secure. He will not let you go. Why? Because that's his name. God saves. God saves. At no point does the name or the plan change to Max saves. I don't save me. The church doesn't save me. The pastor doesn't save me. God saves me. And since he is ultimately victorious, I may stumble, but he will catch me. He will catch me, and he will convict me, and Lord willing, I will repent, but I'll get back on my feet, and with his help, I'll do better next time. That's why Scripture populates. That's why Scripture is populated with verses like this one. He is able to keep you from stumbling and to present you faultless before His presence, before the presence of His glory with exceeding joy. You may lose your self-control, you may lose your perspective, but you'll never lose your salvation because you never earned it to begin with. It was a gift, and He won't take it away. When John the Baptist saw Jesus, he said, "Look, the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world." That's what Jesus came to do. He came to take away the sin of the world. Here's a question. Have you let Him take away yours? Have you? My wife, Deanlin, and I were in a restaurant recently, enjoyed a nice dinner, and then when the attendant came with the check, she gave it and left it, and right behind her was a gentleman I'd never met before, but he had spotted me in the restaurant and recognized me because he attends our church, and he said, "I'd like to meet you," and so we had a nice conversation, and after a few moments, he left. But before he left, he reached down and he took that check. And he said, "I'll take this." Oh, he was a man of God. He's just a godly, wonderful, one of our greatest church members. Just really sets an example for everyone else. I hope they follow. So when the attendant came for my credit card, I didn't have the check. I didn't have it. She came to fetch my credit card, and I said, "He took it." And I pointed at him. He was still in the restaurant, thankfully. I pointed across the restaurant, and I said, "He took the bill." And he lifted it up and waved as if to say, "Yeah, I took it. I no longer had it. I couldn't pay it. It had been taken away." Have you let Jesus take away your sin? According to the Bible, the day is coming in which we will all stand before the judgment seat of the Lord. Every person, without exception, from the richest to the poorest, from the prince to the pauper, and every generation of all days, every person will stand before the judgment seat. That is to say that we will be held accountable for every thought, every deed, and every word. Apart from the grace of Jesus Christ, I would find that thought to be terrifying, terrifying. But because of the grace of Jesus Christ, may I say, I have no fear of that day, none whatsoever. Because I know on that day, when my list of sins is produced, I will point to Jesus Christ. And He may very well lift up a pierced hand, and I will say, "He took it. He took it." Have you let Him take your sin? Maybe you're thinking, "Yeah, but you don't know the things I've done, Lucado. You don't know the life that I've led. You don't know the bad choices, the dumb decisions. You don't know the darkness of my thoughts. You don't know the anger, the hostility. You don't know." I don't. But hear me, please. God does. God does. He knew you when you were in your mother's womb. He knew you before you were conceived. He knew you, and He has seen your life from start to finish, from beginning to end. And He has decided, "I will save that daughter. I will save that son. I am God saves." And He has decided that He wants you in His kingdom. and He will take away your sin. You cannot take it away. I cannot take it away. But God can. Why don't you, if you have a hesitancy about the great gift of God's grace, this year, make sure that you make a visit to Bethlehem. Just go to Bethlehem. In your mind, in your imagination, make that journey up that chalky trail to that crude stable and look at the hay in the manger and then the baby on the hay. Maybe your world resembles that Bethlehem stable. Maybe it's crude in some spots. Maybe it's smelly in others. And maybe one of your relatives really looks a lot like that cow in the corner. And maybe you've thought, you know, my world is just too simple. It's too ordinary. It's too drab for God. Well, God's answer to you is, look how I entered the world. Look where I came. Look where I was born. Imagine Mary as she holds the baby that she knows without a shadow of a doubt, she knows is the miracle child. God saves. His face is prunish and still moist from her womb. Joseph is, he can barely keep his eyes open. He's so tired. And so is Mary. She's weary, but before she closes her eyes, she has to look into the face of God saves. And can you imagine that moment in which she reached down and just ran her thumb across his little brow and said to herself, so this is what God looks like. Because the moment Mary touched the face of God is the moment God made His case for us. There is no place He will not go. There is no person He will not touch. And if He was willing to be born in the Bethlehem stable, don't you know He's willing to enter the brothel, the boardroom, the bedroom, wherever today, to find His children with whom He will populate His new kingdom. And that includes you. Let Him do what He came to do. Let Him love you. Let Him forgive you. Let Him indwell you. Let Him change you. Because of Bethlehem, He can do all of that. By the way, if this message somehow finds its way to the ears of a skinny teenager in East Texas, I have something to say to you. I was wrong. I'm sorry. You were wrong too. But God is working on us both, and God is working on us all. Amen. Heavenly Father, please let Your Holy Spirit take the words of this beautiful passage in which You gave us the name Jesus and explained why He is called Jesus. Would You take this truth and put it deep in our hearts, and we stand against the devil who right now would be wanting to take the seed of hope away from the soil of a life. We stand against him and command him to leave. And in the name of Jesus, we welcome now Your work as You redeem, as You rescue, as You save, as You harvest. Please do Your work. Thank You, Lord.